Agenda item number six, Richard L. Jackson County Judge, Benadryl County Auditor, 6A, set 2019 tax rate 9 AM.
Judge, I've got a motion prepared to set the tax rate. The motion reads, I move that the property tax rate will be increased by the adoption of the tax rate of .4851, which is effectively a 7.5% increase in the current tax rate. I also have the order to set the tax rate on the 23rd day of September 2019 at a meeting of the Commissioners Court of Wilson County, Texas. The court considered setting tax rates for the 2019 tax year. The court found that the 2019 rates will be 36.93 cents for the general operating fund, 8.65 cents for road and bridge, 1.76 cents for the debt service, and 1.17 cents for the library, all for $100 valuation. It is therefore ordered that the tax rates for the 2019 tax year are 36.93 cents for the general operating fund, 8.65 for road and bridge, 1.76 cents for debt service, and 1.17 for the library, all for $100 valuation.
Okay. Eva or Catherine, question, can we do B, approve revenue increase in the same motion, or should I?
I'm sure you can do both of them together, Judge. Is that right?
The revenue increase?
Nope. It's the same, that's what the tax rate does.
The tax rate is set.
But now, is B, approve revenue increase fiscal year 2020? And who needs that, 2019?
It's 1920.
Okay.
Since our fiscal year begins October 1st of 2019.
Okay, then maybe should we say 2019 through 20, or?
It's for the fiscal year, ends 2020.
Okay, the 2019-2020 tax rate is what we're talking about for agenda item A.
So we need a motion?
Yes.
I make a motion that we approve the tax rate and the revenue increase for the year, fiscal year 2019-2020.
Motion by Commissioner Wiley, second by Commissioner Hyatt. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
All opposed.
Okay. Commissioner Gomez?
Yes, sir.
And so we're going to go to agenda item 6B, the approval of revenue increase, which is, if you approve the tax rate, you got to approve the increase, because that's what it's there.
So we covered both of those.
Well, for as far as I'm concerned, we did A, now we need to do B, I guess.
All right. I make a motion that we approve the revenue increase for fiscal year 2020, which is B.
Okay. Okay, motion by Commissioner Wiley, second by Commissioner Hyatt. Is there any discussion on this? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Comments? Opposed? Okay, what we're going to do now, we've been asked to move forward in the agenda on three different items. Of course, we have people here. Can I have one more thing to do?
currently have two filled part-time positions that process express transactions and the driver. Our office lost two employees recently, one at the end of May and one at the beginning of July. Both of these employees left our office because they found better paying jobs. I have provided each of you with a copy of their resignation letters. We have listed the positions several times, only to receive applications that are either not qualified or not willing to work for the salary we have to offer. We have, however, hired the replacement that is included in the filled full-time positions.
The reason for today is to request that the salary of the open position be divided between us. We weigh the options and feel this is the best decision for our office and for the citizens of Bolton County. We have an amazing office staff and we're willing to do the extra work. Due to the high turnover in our office, the company has been working on this project. And our ability to service the customers at the level we know they deserve.
Our office cost time last year, which means that any of us can process any type of transactions for customers. And we have gone from four tax employees and five audio employees to eight fully trained employees that process transactions with property taxes, DMV, Texas Parks and Wildlife, and VIP transactions.
Yes, we knew what the salary was when we were hired. However, we did not know what the job consisted of. But our office began collecting taxes for all entities and more than doubled our workload. When we cross-trained, the workload tripled. Each one of us was doing the work of what three people used to do. Due to the amount of training and knowledge the positions consist of, we feel the higher salary request is justified and well deserved.
Okay. I'm one of the county representatives, and that amount of time we've lost 18 employees. Three of them were terminated or left for different reasons, three people retired, but 12 people left their office for better paying jobs. And we have still a lot, and not from 10, so part-time people that want 40 every 9 months. The hiring happens so often, we're constantly training the employees. Training in our office with as many different interactions that we process takes several months. For an employee to be fully, takes up a time to be fully While training, we have 1 hour of clerk sent away from their desk to assist in the hiring. At times we may have more than one new employee. So basically multiple of us are away from our desk at one time. And this makes taxpayers really frustrated because they're taking longer to wait on customers, or it's taking longer for us to wait on customers, or they'll go to someone that's not knowledgeable in everything. It's very easy to say that we knew the deal when we started. When I started, I was just like, oh, you weren't cross-trained, you weren't doing our salon, and you didn't absorb all the extra things from the great district. So that's probably what you're not working at. It's also very interesting. We've been offered jobs at other county offices that make one of Wilson County. And I know all the offices in Wilson County don't make the budgets. All the offices in Wilson County are maybe the same that we are, but it's just, we've been offered other jobs. Neighboring county tax office says that we draw on this and several of those are worth it. Majority of the state is the Lord's sort of concern. As far as me, being chief deputy, not being chief deputy, hey, that just shows how much I love you. 2 years ago, I lost my son.
I have requested raises for my employees for three consecutive years. salaries have not been increased to what they should be earning for this level of skill position. There are approximately 15 Wilson County employees that make under $30,000, and half of them are in the tax office. There are new employees in the county that were hired and have higher salaries than most of the tax office employees. The reason the salaries are so low in this office is because of the high turnover in the past. Each time an employee left the office, the salary would be lower to entry level. In 2016, before I came into office, the total salary budget for the tax office was $564,885.79. The approved salary budget for 2020 is $536,217.07. This means that 4 years ago, the salary budget in the Wilson County Tax Office was $28,668.72 more than what it is today. I have managed to increase the services provided at less cost to the taxpayers. The best thing that a business can invest in is its employees. When you have happy and loyal employees, it increases their attitude and productivity. Therefore, they work harder and provide better service to the community. If the request is not granted, we will more than likely lose trained, valuable, qualified employees, and Wilson County cannot afford this to happen. I ask that each of you consider this request, and once again, thank you for your time.
I'm sorry for the first question. I hate to see anything like that. That's terrible. As far as compensation, okay, Wilson County, since I've only been here 4 years, this is the fifth year, okay, two different times, and this is one of the years at that time, it was a $2,000 raise to the end of the employee. Before that, it was 17 years before it happened twice. Raises, I mean, excuse me, salaries have not decreased, never, in Wilson County. They've always increased. I apologize, Wilson County is not as wealthy as the counties that surround us. We're competing with Guadalupe County for deputies, jailers, clerks, everything else. Atascosa County, the same way, they have oil revenue that we don't have. Barrett County is not even, we can't even compare with them. I appreciate all of the hard work that y'all do and the dedication that you give. This is not just a tax office concern, this is a concern across, we have several other county clerk, district clerk, county treasurer, other offices that are the same as well. Anybody else have anything?
I do. I want to just clarify something. I'm not sure that that she expressed exactly what the request is, because she did meet with me prior to get clarification. She has an open position in her budget, so the money is already budgeted in her salaries. She is requesting to eliminate that full-time position and use that budgeted salary to be split amongst her employees according to the spreadsheet that is attached. So for clarification, she is not requesting additional money that has not already been budgeted and approved by you. She's requesting that it be moved from one open position that she wants to eliminate and plug into her staff in order to, because they're taking on additional responsibility. Is that correct?
I guess the question that I would have to that is, I think we're all aware of the next year's budget is going to be interesting. So if you eliminate this position and you come back next year and say, boy, I wish I hadn't eliminated that position because now I'm short as far as coverage,
I have no intention on doing that. My employees and I have discussed all the options, and we feel that this is the best thing for the office, for the citizens of the county. And I mean, it's This is what we feel we need to do to keep our qualified employees in our office.
Based on some of the comments I heard, saying they can't take off bereavement leave because they're too busy, it would seem to me that the additional employee would allow them to take off more.
She was never denied time to take off.
It's not her office, she was in hiring a person and they changed it in front of she left the user things and then I hired an office and then we were able to hire two offices.
Now, the other comment about more work, it seems like the additional employee would help. You know, we have to be very conscientious about everywhere we put money. And whenever we give these additional raises like this, that's not just a raise in the salary, it's a raise in how much we have to put in the retirement. It's a raise in how much we have to pay taxes for each individual. So the raise we discuss sounds minimal, but it's actually a bigger expenditure burden.
But it's not because we're taking a salary that's already budgeted, that already has all of those.
When you apply that to everyone else's salary, that increases their rate of tax. County actually then increases the amount of retirement that you put in. For all your individuals now, except that one. So the tax burden is, and the expenditures are much greater spread out over all those people than one extra employee.
Can I ask a question? I understand that portion of it, but would you pay health insurance to that individual? So would that not save you some money monthly? Because we already all have health insurance. So would you not be saving?
Well, then next year, the raise is coming around.
Would it not balance?
No. No, not over the long term.
So medical insurance would be less expensive to pay for somebody than to put in 7% of my retirement and I would get what I'm vested?
Well, when you look at the long term, yeah, but it'd be much more expensive.
You don't have employees staying long term.
That's our problem. I mean, the turnover in the office because of the low salary causes us to have to continuously train new employees, which in turn hurts every single one of you and hurts the citizens of this county. You know, nobody knows how this operates. This office operates any better than what we do.
The same argument can be made with every department, though.
Absolutely.
And what we're saying is, we're not a wealthy county. Our surrounding neighbors are.
You're absolutely right. But did we not just give some high raises in the budget this year? Yes, we. These employees got $2,000, but there were some employees that got $6,000, $7,000, I believe even $8,000.
Did you ever get a raise like that?
No, I never got a single one. When I moved from the county clerk's office to the judge's office, I came in at that salary. I was never increased a large amount.
That was a move from your county clerk salary to your office in the county judge? Was that a big increase?
Yes, it was.
I mean, but that has nothing to do with our salaries. What we're requesting right now is our salary. Something that's already in the budget that has already been approved in her budget to allow her the opportunity to disperse that budget the way she pleases in order for us to be able to provide more and better customer service, for us to be able to say, you know what, we have the resources. We're going to take the time and more energy to invest in our customers because we have the resources to look at. Because we've been here long enough to say, hey, you know what, I know where to go look at. Instead of somebody who's new and comes in and says, you know, I'm sorry, customer, I don't know, I don't have an answer to that. But let me call it out. Sit there for 30 minutes while I'll look up this information. We're not asking for more, we're just asking you to allow her to do what she already has in her budget.
This is not benefiting me in any way. Yes, it's benefiting the employees, which...
The problem is going to be is that you have a space available. And like, in our situation, I got one available too, and I probably won't hire. Now, I probably have like $50,000 in my budget, so I can come back to Commissioner's Court and say, you know what, that $25,000 I want to give to my three employees.
This is already been done.
No, but on that bill that I have for that employee now, that's going to increase their pay raise a lot. And I'm not for that increasing a lot of my employees, because they already, two of them already left. In the past year, there's like six that have left. Because there are paid a high quality paying job that they can go out there and find. That's the same with the sheriff's department. You've got a big turnover at the Justice Center.
None of these employees that you're speaking of make under $30,000 a year.
But you see, but they're.
But we've got janitors that are making over $30,000 a year.
But $30,000, you're going to come back and say next year, well, $30,000, they're going to cut it, we still need them.
No, I'm not.
I have to pay for insurance. I mean, I have insurance for my child. And so by the time everything gets taken out, if you look at my check, I get paid $592 every 2 weeks. Do you think that I would be happy coming to work every day, dealing with customers, yelling at me, when I need to just, sometimes I'm just like, is this even worth it? Am I just going to have to go out and find something else? But I don't want to, because I want to work here. You know, can you live off of $592 every 2 weeks?
Commissioner Hyatt, I wanted to, going back to clarification for your report, I think it was her question. It's about $12,000, maybe plus a little bit, in terms of fringe benefits outside of what's been budgeted for salaries. So I just wanted to make that clear in terms of her question on the health salary. So we, in essence, we would be, once she, if she fills the open position of the 20, I think it's opened up $23,082 as minimum starting salary. In addition to that, we would have to pay an additional $12,000 for fringe benefits to include health insurance and all that. So I just wanted to make sure that that was clear in terms of the dollars.
So in essence, it'd be saving money to the county.
I'm just clarifying.
Right, no, and I'm just saying it would save money. Yeah.
I mean, like, I'm having health problems right now, so I'm gonna have to make a $2,000 deductible when I'm having to put this on credit cards because this has gone up. And now, I mean, how does this $2,000 raise really help me that they gave the county?
I wish we were able to give everybody in the county a big raise. We're behind, we're not behind, we're probably right at Carnes and Gonzales County, which are close to us. We're behind other counties. We're a zero cost, but every penny in there, okay, when anything goes up, the tax rate goes up, or the revenue has to go up to compensate for that. It goes straight. Everything that happens in Wilson County gets paid for straight by the ad valorem taxpayer, the people that own the property and pay the property taxes to the county.
And who collects all that money? Every single one of these employees is.
Okay, well, is that their job description?
Absolutely,
okay.
It is.
I mean, I'm saying where it came from. Everybody has to have a job. Eva's office has their job. Jan's office has their job. We have human resources. We have emergency management. We have elections. We have district work. Everybody's got a job. Everybody should work at doing their job proficiently. One thing a while ago, and it was alluded to, that this has been done before. It hasn't. I think it was alluded that Albert did it. Albert did not do it. Albert did the same thing and happens in other offices. Somebody left and lowered that position down to the entry level, and that money was taken into money. And you've done that before amongst the employees.
Either way, that's not something, this is not gonna cost the county any additional money. This is something that we feel is best for our office.
Okay, and we're setting a precedence, and then Eva has the option of doing the same thing. Jan has the option of doing the same thing.
Sure,
Debbie has
but
the option
to
do the same thing.
Okay, have Commissioner's Court and fight for this.
Okay.
Exactly as I do. Exactly as these employees are doing.
Okay.
I mean, I would like an explanation from each one of you as to why you feel this isn't something that will benefit the county.
Well, I'm not saying it won't benefit
job for doing this double role and also collecting for the Texas Parks and Wildlife and voting. That was your choice. The court didn't tell you to do that. These employees knew what their job was when they were hired. They should have been on anyway. I mean, the biggest problem I have, we have, and I'm not the judge and Commissioner Donald, I wish we could pay a whole lot more. But the biggest turnover we have is in the jail. And you want to pay your employees, not saying they're not worth the money, but what we pay the jail for, dealing with federal prisoners, everybody else that's in that jail.
I'd like for you to come sit in that office for a week.
I'm not saying you take my phone calls for a week, dog.
Each one of you, take a turn. Come sit in that office.
Okay. We're going to move on. If anybody has any other comments, is there a motion being?
Public can't comment right now, can they?
Pardon?
Public can't comment right now, can they?
There's nobody that filed it.
I have a comment on what you said.
Excuse me? Okay. No, public can't comment. You should have signed a,
I was just saying, public comment.
I agree with what I was coming into as a tax.
Okay, excuse me. We're moving on.
We're not going to say more.
Excuse me, we're moving on. Okay, do we have a motion on this?
I'll make a motion that we, not make any adjustments, to the salaries of the employees.
Okay, do we have to have a motion for that?
No.
Okay.
Okay, then this agenda item dies for lack of motion. Okay, we have been asked also to go to agenda item 21B for, okay, this is, 21B is considered to take action regarding a resolution authorizing the submission of an application to the Hazard Mitigation Grant Program. This is for project Albert Estelman Value for 128.
So the Hazard Mitigation Grant Program has, will be accepting applications till some point in December. And a project that Mr. Gomez has already, it's been designed and the construction plans are prepared, scope of work off, it's pretty much ready to go out for bid, is eligible for submitting a grant application. The process starts with a resolution. If we are going to use a consultant to help us write the application as well as administer the application, we are required to go through a pre-procurement process before submitting the application. If we are going to use engineering services, any professional services need to be pre-procured. We would, in the past week, used professional services to write applications and administer the grant. Since the project has already been designed, scope of work has been done, the engineer services that would be done for the application, if our application were not chosen, would not be paid, plus we would be using a contract engineer that the county has a contract with, an ongoing contract with, that would not be reimbursed either. If we were to continue to use the same engineer, if our application were approved, to help us through the process of developing the bid packet and then monitoring the project, inspections and stuff, that would not be eligible for reimbursement because it is a engineer that's on contract with the county. So,
this grant application isn't for a specific incident. This is just so we can be part of the hazard mitigation program.
No, this
it's through the it's the hazard mitigation program opens up anytime there is a a disaster, and the jurisdictions that were affected by the disaster.
jurisdictions in the state of Texas are eligible to apply. And I believe this, which disaster did she say it was from?
The land flooding.
Yes, these funds were made available after the land flooding.
And for anything that is, okay, it has to be on our mitigation plan that we submitted last year, and this project is. There's a lot of other counties that could be available. They didn't even submit a mitigation plan, or they didn't, they haven't got projects or whatever. This will,
so
it'll go on ours. And with Russell working with us, the way he's going to work with us, that's going to help us. Because we would have to submit the plan, and we don't know if we get the grant. If we don't get the grant, then that would come out of our pocket. Since Russell's working with us, he said he's going to work with us on this. We don't have to worry about that.
That would be for the whole road, or is it certain area?
Probably from San Sandy Fire, past a little bit, and then in Moscow. 155.
Is it matching or is it total?
The grant is a 25% match. If you use some of your force account, you know, your county employees, they use some of the work that could go towards the match. If there was a force account labor as well.
Would you already pay for the engineer?
Now,
is that part of the match account?
No. We've already got the engineering done, so we would not
go back and we'll go to agenda item 20, or Mr. Graham. Okay, then we'll get back in the right order. Okay, agenda item number 20, Richard L. Jackson, planning to discuss and take action on creating a new part-time position for the Veterans Service Office. You want me to do it? You want to do it? Okay, Mr. Graham has Susan Barnes. Okay, she's wanting to be a volunteer. She has worked for out there for several months in the Veterans Service Office. Okay, Mr. Graham and Susan both want to get her credit. To do that, she has to be an employee of Wilson County, a part-time employee. So we have to put her on payroll. She still needs to be considered volunteer, but she has agreed to get accredited, and to get accredited, we've got to put her on the payroll. She is volunteer, or said she would be on the payroll for 1 hour a month, for 1 hour pay period.
I'm sorry, Your Honor, we have to pay her minimum wage for an hour. I called TVC this morning.
Okay.
State and federal law says that we do have to employ her. It would be a minimum wage.
Okay. And then instead of 1 hour pay period, it's going to be 20 hours of pay period?
Correct.
Okay.
And we would have to have a letter. We have to.
Okay, here's the next problem. All right. So we don't have the money in the budget.
So we do not have the money. So may I suggest that I take a pay cut? And that pay then will go to pay her $7.25 an hour. That'll provide the county 3 accredited officers as the Veterans County Service Officer. As you know, I've been doing this since you appointed me 3 years ago. We're just about doubled, if not more, about every month. And by my efforts and your gracious allowing me to do it, you know, we've come on radar with the state, and so we are growing because people are coming in. So this additional person, if we can get her 20 hours a week, we've already got all the equipment. The days that I'm not there, she can use the other office. So right now with Valerie, who we've already hired 20 hours a week, she's there Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays. I'm there Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Susan has also been already approved by the VA to be the Wilson County Veteran Service Office Vehicle Control Officer for the VA van that's been given us. She will be driving that, and she will be overseeing the volunteer drivers. But in the days that she's not driving, she would then be in the office, and she would be trained to be as accredited as I am, and Valerie is working towards that. So really, in providing this position, if you need to take it from my pay, I'm for that. The result will be as a county will be triple where it's ever been before, and it's not dependent upon one person, me, making it happen. So that's kind of my proposal. In the 3 years that I've been doing this, I've had all the phone calls and all the emails forwarded to my personal cell. A lot of times when I'm not in the office, I'm still working. So I'm willing to make the sacrifice because I believe in what we're doing, and it's growing. So I'm proud of what I get to do. Triple my effort. That's about all I have to say, right? I'd rather not take a pay cut, but I really do want that person. Okay.
So currently, with Mr. Grimm's salary and Valerie, who is the paid part-time position right now, for the new fiscal year, $35,138.55 is what's budgeted for those two positions combined. If we were to add a third part-time employee at $7.25 an hour for a minimum of 1,000 hours, that would be an additional $7,250 needed to be added to his budget, not decreasing his salary by that amount. In addition to that, we would have to pay into payroll taxes, but there would be no benefits paid out for that person or
retirement.
Retirement, yes. So in essence, if if I'm hearing him correctly, he wants to decrease his salary by $7,250 plus retirement and taxes, which, I mean, off the top of my head, I would say it's somewhere around another $1,000. So decreasing his salary by $8,000, his current salary is $18,585. So it's almost in half.
Okay. These would be numbers. Okay, say we decrease his salary for, say, $6,000. And then with the extra benefits offered, that'd be about $7,000. Would that be? Can we juggle the numbers out of there?
Well, you would still have to be requesting the court to approve an additional $3,000 plus to cover the difference. If we were to decrease his salary, any amount that we decrease his salary that's not equivalent to the total compensation package for what he's requesting, we would have to pay the difference or increase the budget by the difference. And I don't know what that exact number is without plugging the numbers in to see what the tax rate and retirement amount would be on $1,000. I mean, I can tell you what an average part-time employee is, but that would be different, I guess.
Okay.
So I'm going to make sure I understand that answer that she would have to work, she would be required to work at minimum 20 hours per week. Yes?
Business purposes, the county is still responsible for any liability.
And we have immunity from most kinds of damages, but the one we don't have immunity for is moving vehicles.
Well, again, I can't respond to that. All I know is, Your Honor, we've gone over this ad nauseum with the VA.
Well,
Well, again, we're back to when we secured the van, it was brought to us from Atascosa County. And it was driven by an Atascosa employee who is credentialed by the VA to drive the van. So, again, same thing in Guadalupe County. They have a van and their employee drives it. So, again, it's part of what the VA puts out. It's a volunteer service, but I mean, bottom line is, I'm sorry, Your Honor.
I have a question on her. The driver's license that it takes to be eligible to drive the van and all passengers.
Correct. You don't have to have a CDL license.
If she doesn't, or you don't have to.
You sure? I mean, it may not.
Again, you're dealing with, again, it's the VA's, this is going to sound odd, but it's the VA's money. It's the VA world. They have their laws that everybody else. I mean, the VA owns the money, the VA owns the whole system. They dictate, and it's all approved by federal. So even when it comes down to the county level, again, again, going back to answer your question, yes, we've already asked that directly to TVC, which is the state, as well as met with their volunteer services director. So,
I think her concern is, knowing Texas litigation, regardless of who owns it, if we have an employee or volunteer representing the county owns it, we're litigating also. That's
right. If that employee driving the van was employed by the VA, there would be no question, but you're asking for the employee to be employed by Wilson County driving a VA van.
Well, it's probably going to be back to us and we'd be a litigant also, because if they find out that those passengers are being hauled because of the veteran service also of Wilson County, then they're going to trace that back to us anyway. So,
well, and
I really don't have a problem.
Well, if I will say, Your Honor, we've had the van since April. We've gone through a lot of tweaking to get to where we're taking it in Monday to have it repainted. Then we're going to have magnetic signs, which are about $300. Or we're going to put boldly Wilson County, Texas Veterans Service Office on the side of it. The van is actually owned by the DAV. They donated it. So the plastic wrap that's on it is going to be completely removed. Now, I would need to know this week, if we are not going to utilize the van, I need to contact Congressman Henry Cuellar and get the van back. I mean, that's pretty simple. We've had it since April. It's already been in the newspaper. So these are good questions, but I think we're, you know, a couple of months behind. If we were to come back, it's good. You've got a good question.
Asked the very first day.
Ma'am, I'm just letting you know. These are good questions, but these questions should have been to me back in April, and now we're coming up to Monday, it goes in to be repainted, and I've already been through this with the VA. So again, I'm willing to take a pay cut. I'm here to help our county. When I came on 3 years ago, I made a point to say, I'm not trying to build a crystal cathedral nobody can fill when the good word takes me. And we're at that point now. So if we don't have the money, I'm willing to take it out. But at the same time, I'm helping you create a department. I'm just a part-time employee. You pay me at 24 hours on schedule. I work 27 because I can't work anymore. Evidently, there's federal laws. I can't work full-time. But back in November, when I was working 5 days a week, I saw 96 veterans that month. I saw almost 80 last month, and that's just doing 3 days. So your county in the last 3 years has come up to the point. place that we're on radar with Boston. Grace Bible Church is picking up the tab for our quarterly breakfast. We average between 80 and 100. We have a phenomenon going on in Wilson County. And all I did was open the blinds and turn the light on.
Okay, let's get back to the... I have no problem with Susan driving the van, because like I said, if they find out that those people were in there from Wilson County Veteran Service Office, they're going to use us as a delegate anyway.
As a volunteer, is what you're saying, Judge? Currently.
What's that?
You're saying currently as a volunteer?
Well, I mean, if somebody from the Veterans Affairs Office came down and drove the van, and they found out they were hauling Wilson County Veteran Service, people that our office, got in there to use them to use that for transportation to get them to San Antonio.
Yes.
We're still going to be able to do it. That was the purpose of the van, to haul our people from Wilson County. I have no problem with Susan driving the van, because we're going to be, as long as we have insurance to cover everything, kick it off on them if something happens. Pray nothing ever happens.
Does our insurance cover a volunteer?
No, that's the van, all about the VA, is all that our insurance covers.
No. Okay.
I just have one question, Judge. Is the VA paying for the expenses? You talked about signs and painting.
We pay for anything that has Wilson County on it, but everything else the VA pays for.
Okay.
VA pays for the insurance. Tires, maintenance, oil, gas.
It's not going to be a vehicle insured by us. No.
So the insurance card's going to say VA?
Yeah. It's all, the whole thing is the VA.
And the other person here. What can that person do credentialed with the VA that they can't do without being credentialed by the VA?
Oh, okay. So, I have, because of my training, and you have to be on paper a 20-hour paid employee, okay, to be eligible to be trained to be an accepted by the VA, accredited veteran service officer for a county. So I'm it. So with Valerie being trained, we hired her at $10 an hour. She's being trained right now, going through it, and she will be accredited. First you're credentialed, and then you're accredited, which means we can sign off on the documents that we submit to the VA.
So she'll have two of y'all here when she finishes her.
Correct. And if we can get Susan, she also will then be accredited, and so you'll have three people available to do what I'm doing by myself, and then when I'm not there, you're still going to have two accredited people doing it. So the result is you tripled your effort for $37,000.
You don't think that you could provide the services you need now with you two?
You're
both three right there.
Well, the truth of the matter is, you're going to triple your effect for, think about it. If you're paying me 18 and I'm going to make a pay cut and you're going to get another person, you're going to triple the effort for what you're paying me.
I understand that. I'm just saying.
Well, on the budget.
You work as a one-man show admirably for 3 years, and now you're about to add second, which is going to double your efforts.
Correct.
But you want to add third real quick. Why don't we work with this company here, and see how that works out? See if we can expand it for the following year.
Well, I think that's a
good idea. That way you have an employee who's a volunteer.
Well,
hey, employee, you don't lose any money, but you still have that extra person answering the phones and doing all the peripheral stuff. But we all need your credit stuff.
Yeah. John, we're going to get that phone line drop. So we have a phone, we just need to have the phone line drop.
Did that make sense to you, though?
Oh, it makes all perfect sense. Okay. And of course, the whole goal is, how do we make what we're doing fit into the value of the only money? This is all the money we get.
I just gave that to you, sir.
So with that said, no.
Two accredited people and one volunteer.
Okay.
For this year.
But the volunteer won't get the credit.
Well, you don't need the volunteer. That's why I'm saying he's been working with just
I know.
Credit. He's going to have two of this lady finish their accreditation.
Okay, so.
That'll know their result. You'll have a volunteer to do the other stuff that's not regular, like answer phone, make appointments and stuff like that. They give you all the time to do the accreditation test. True?
Well, there's more, y'all have seen my stats, and you don't, for those that have been in the building and watched how the tempo goes, I'm getting phone calls while I'm sitting here. I know there was a veteran, I came in this morning at 8 o'clock, already had somebody coming in as soon as I took the light off.
And that's what the volunteer does, thank you for the call for you, or you're visiting people. And you have just regular people.
I understand what you're saying, but I don't think you're grasping the tempo that is built. So I'm only making the presentation. I understand if you don't have any money, you don't have any money. But the county is being offered the opportunity of making that investment. I said, hey, I'll do it. But if you want me to keep getting paid what I'm paid, all right.
Yeah, let's try with the two accredited people this year. When will this other individual be accredited?
Oh, I can't tell you. I don't know. There's training that the state will go through. The initial training the state pays for.
Okay.
And I don't even know where that's at. And there'll be training, and I can't remember if it's in December right now. And when I'm
the initial training I pay for, is there additional?
Yes,
training.
A lot of it now is online. And so we actually have that set up. Okay.
Let's take one step at a time.
Well, I like this step.
What can a volunteer, according to the VA, what can a volunteer do?
Answer phones. That's it. Getting the individual credential, when I'm not in the office, that other individual would be able to utilize, gain access to the records. They would, because that's what I was when I came on 3 years ago.
And that's the other person doing that.
And then, yes.
You've got the credential to do that when you're out of the office, correct?
Correct. And then when I
meet the rooms.
And then also, if you've already purchased the licensure and the for the digital submission, we bought that last year in the computer. So when I'm out there, if that individual is a paid and a credential, they can actually utilize that too. So really what the result would be is you would have two people in the office basically at all times. So I'm going to be gone for 2 weeks in the middle of October. I have a family reunion, and since my sister and brother-in-law are in their 80s, I want to see them before they're gone. So when I'm not here, without credential people, the office kind of basically shuts down. So again, I think Skip, you've got a great point. I'm just here trying to build my staff up, and for the minimum that we're getting paid. And we knew that when we came online.
Right.
So.
First, I think getting the second person credential.
Skip, you're just upset because I took your own. No, I'm kidding. Skip, hey,
He's upset because they got a new door and he didn't get a new door.
Oh, look what it is.
Well, you got a new door.
So, but anyway.
I'm just saying, I'm trying to get us to walk a little faster, sure, and start running. And you've done an excellent job, Attorney. You know, I've told you that many times.
Thanks.
And I would suggest, I don't think that this is anything that you hadn't thought of months back, but maybe had this come before the court, before the budget was adopted, we could have budgeted for the third position rather than having to make a decision on taking the pay cut.
Yeah.
Right, that's what I'm saying. So for next year, it might be a possibility.
Yeah.
Honestly,
let's walk this through next year and budget for three next year.
So,
well, and if for some reason, the reason being the limitation of new funds in the new budget, if next year, as we get closer and we see what it's going to be,
sure,
that would require you taking a pay increase in order to go forward, then I would be in favor of that.
Okay. There's a question. Okay. So I guess on agenda item 20, no action taken.
All
right.
Yes.
Anybody agree on that?
I'm not leaving because I'm angry, it's just I have a veteran at 10 o'clock. So, don't go away, man.
I'm not. You guys don't worry.
Just go away.
Alright.
I'll be back.
Okay. proclamation.
We have a proclamation.
Yes.
Would you like to introduce yourself? Would you like to read your proclamation?
Sure. I'm Hannah Klug. I'm from the Guadalupe Valley Family Violence Shelter and Crisis Center. We have a non-residential service office here in Forestville, and we're based primarily in Seguin, but we serve Wilson, Carnes, Guadalupe, and Gonzales counties, both non-residential and residential services for survivors of violence, whether it's sexual violence or domestic violence. But this month, or in October, it'll be Domestic Violence Awareness and Prevention Month. So I will move the proclamation. Whereas the crime of domestic violence violates an individual's privacy, dignity, security, and humanity due to systematic use of physical, emotional, sexual, psychological, and economic control and or abuse, including the abuse to children and the elderly. Whereas the problems of domestic violence are not confined to any group or groups of people, but cut across all economic, racial, and societal barriers, and are supported by societal differences. And whereas the impact of domestic violence is wide-ranging, directly affecting individuals and society as a whole here in this community, throughout the United States, and whereas women are not the only targets, young children and the elderly also are victims, and sadly, emotional scars are often permanent, and domestic violence costs United States companies at least $3.5 billion in lost work time, increased healthcare costs, higher turnover, and lower productivity. And whereas it is battered women themselves who have been in the forefront of efforts to bring peace and equality to the home. Now, therefore, we do hereby proclaim the month of October as Domestic Violence Awareness and Prevention Month, and call all citizens, community agencies, religious organizations, medical facilities, and businesses to increase their participation in our effort to prevent domestic violence, thereby strengthening the communities in which we live. Presented this 23rd day of September 2019.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much. Well, Jennifer.
She is at the office right now covering for our advocate.
She is the advocate.
Yes. She motion. Called me right before I walked in.
Motion by Commissioner Gobbins, second by Commissioner Whitey. Is there any comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you. Thank you. Would you like to get a picture?
Sure.
Jennifer. No one was all stand up.
This is the one that comes
maybe the next day. Pardon?
Do you have a sealed document?
Well, we will get you, I think.
That's it, Judge. Oh, that's the original.
Okay. We'll sign this one.
Change lenses.
No, okay.
Oh, wide angle, huh?
Thank you for gathering together.
Are we doing the all the streets down here? Or?
Yeah. Yes, three.
Oh, wonderful. Now I can walk with that brand new.
They're just going to cut the limbs and let them drop where they are.
That's right. You pick them up, that's good, that's good exercise.
It is, total is $5,125, and it's for a total of 21 trees. Each of those 21 have different prices. I guess it depends on the size of the kind of trees, yes. But $5,125.
I think the most they include, it's for the bronze.
It's bronze, yes, it's a bronze tree service at a velocity.
$5,125.
$5,125.
$25.
Motion by Commissioner Tamayo, second by Commissioner Thomas. Is there any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? So turn to the trees.
I think that would be a good meeting, please, for you.
Yes.
That was a good one. Okay, Richard Bowe, Jackson, agenda item.
Jack, I'm sorry, I missed the second. She was out, it's $5,125.
Okay.
Approval of the tip. Thank you very much.
Okay, agenda item number nine, Richard Bowe, Jackson County Judge, discuss and take action on holidays and paydays for 2020. That is, Commissioner Body passed out for the vote. Got 14, the same 14 holidays we've had forever, and the paydays continue every other Friday. Longevity will be Wednesday, November the 25th, 2020. And I'm going to take it that the 27th is Black Friday.
Yes.
That is the day after Thanksgiving, Judge.
Other than that, everything's second.